And now it's back to the city of Bath and that curious family of peregrines with Yolo Williams.
Welcome back to beautiful Bath, where on St John's Church over there we have a unique family of peregrines. Now I'm going to show you something that will have Chris rubbing his thighs with glee. These are prayer remains collected by peregrine guru Ed below this aiary here. And take a look at these, just a sample. That's a water rail skull. Here I have feathers from an incredibly rare bird, the corncrake, and these are the wings of a woodcock. Now the question is, what on earth are these doing below the nest of an urban peregrine? Well, I came to Bath a week ago when the chicks were four weeks old to get the answer to that very question. The peregrine chicks are thriving. Their adult plumage is now starting to poke through. As they approach fledging, they'll need more food than ever. Their parents will have their work cut out, even with their legendary hunting prowess. But there's new research that shows city peregrines might have developed an advantage. Now, this time of the evening, rural peregrines are settling down for the night. But for urban peregrines, it's a different matter. To find out what gives these city predators the edge, I've come to meet Ed Druitt for a night on the town with a difference. Even at this time of night, you've seen quite a few pigeons, and I suppose they must constitute most of the peregrine's prey, do they?
Well, you'd think pigeons would, but actually here in cities like Bath, they only take up about 42% of the diet. So the rest, the 60% or so, is actually other birds. A lot of wooden birds, garden birds, but also things such as corncrake and woodcock, blacknecked grebe, quail, and a whole variety of other unusual birds.
But hang on now. These birds migrate at night.
Exactly, so they're normally sort of tucked away. But when they're migrating at night, they become exposed over cities like here in Bath because they have pale bellies, and there's loads of street lamps, of course, in the city, and all those lights are lighting up these birds like beacons.
That is absolutely amazing. The evidence comes from items collected beneath the nest.
I've got, for example, a pellet here and a skull from a little grebe. And so it's by finding this evidence, these clues on the ground, that we've actually worked out the peregrines are eating these sorts of birds.
Tonight, we're not spotting much, even with the help of the streetlights. But if we head up into the church tower, we'll see just what our peregrine family is up to.
Hey, Will. How's it going? Are you all right?
Yeah, all good, thanks.
What have we got?
Two wow. Sleeping peregrine chicks.
Fantastic. I've never seen a peregrine nest at night before, so it's great to see it in infrared.
It looks like the chicks are now old enough for their parents to leave them unattended overnight. When something wakes them from their slumber, I wonder if one of the adults is returning. But we've been staking out the nest for weeks and have yet to see the family hunting at night.
I'm amazed by the lack of activity. You know, they're not actually doing very much, are they?
Yeah, well, I think because there's two of them and there's three sort of adultish birds bringing food in, there's actually enough food probably being brought in during the daytime. But there's plenty of evidence elsewhere of both chicks being fed throughout the night, but also the birds, the adult birds, hunting at night as well.
This is archive footage from Derby Cathedral, a woodcock brought back still alive at around 11 p.m. The shots aren't sharp, but they're proof that urban peregrines hunt at night. With committed parents, a full-time helper, and the option of round-the-clock care, our peregrine chicks seem to be perfectly catered for. It won't be long before they join the growing ranks of adult urban peregrines. That's fascinating, isn't it? That's evolution in action for you. And of course, with an increasing number of peregrines moving into these urban areas, people like Ed monitoring them, and high-tech equipment, who knows what the next discoveries will be. Right, I think it's long overdue time that we went and caught up with our chicks. So let's go live to our nest camera up on the church there. Look at that. What a difference a week makes. How they've come on. And you can see there that they're preening away, trying to get rid of the few remaining downy feathers. They're looking magnificent. They must be 5 weeks old now, And for the first year, they'll have those brown feathers. They look like juveniles until they molt, and going into their second year with a male, we'll get his slaty grey back. And probably you can sex them. The female is quite a bit bigger than the male. Oh, there we are. That'll be the female on the right. She bobs her head up there. Look at that. Beautiful birds. Absolutely stunning. And don't forget, these are the fastest birds in the world, diving at speeds of well over 120 miles an hour. And if you look at the church now, you'll see quite a few pigeons scattered around, perched up over there. They're safe as long as they're perched, but once they launch themselves off into the wild blue yonder, that's when they become peregrine food. Take a look at this footage we shot yesterday. This is the female feeding one of the chicks there. And at this stage, actually, the chicks can feed themselves. That's the young female pecking away, probably at a pigeon leg, I think she is, on there. But the female will carry on coming in with food. They'll dump food more and more now, so they'll be feeding themselves as well. And this is the footage I like. Reminds me of a scene from the film Lady and the Tramp, where they share some spaghetti, only the female is fighting for a bit of pigeon intestine with one of the chicks. Look at that, using her talon there as well. Nowhere near as tasty as spaghetti, I don't think. Now, before we go, let's have one last live look at our chicks and see what they're doing at this very moment. Yeah, still preening. Not doing very much, really. They'll probably settle down for the evening soon. And the evening, I'm told, is a time when Bath comes alive. The night clubs here are heaving. So I've been working on my dances all day. I've got the moves all worked out. So I'm going to hand you back to Wales while I go and disco the night away.
Well, you have a great time discoing. We've got our moves sorted out as well, Yolo, mainly to avoid the midges, to be honest with you. But let's stick with our nest theme, the sighting of the nest and their structure. Take a look up here, because here is a greater spotted woodpecker's nest. Now, the young have fledged. They left a few days ago, so we're not disturbing them. But you can see that's a structure which is excavated itself.
It has. Now, all this week we've been using a specialist thermal camera to try to reveal, give us new insights into wildlife. And we've turned the camera today onto some of our nests. Now, there's the nest. That's a little flycatcher nest. But look at it now with a thermal camera. It's almost like a volcanic vent. But that nest is beautifully insulated, you can see. Now, here's a nest box. There's nothing in that nest box. And the temperature is exactly the same as the tree that it's actually on. But here's one in use. It's a flycatcher. Now, have a look as it goes in. You can see the bird there burning out. It's very warm. Actually glows as the parent goes in, but down at the bottom there, it's quite well insulated, that nest box. But I'm surprised at how much heat is getting out of it. Now, here we've got a crow's nest. Now, you might think crow's nest is just a bunch of sticks, but actually we were given a bit of a surprise. Because when we put the thermal camera on it, it's not bad, but Chris, down at the bottom there,
it's leaking heat. Now that surprises me, because although the nest is made of sticks, the crows do line them.
Yeah, they do. And here, now this is our lovely goldcrest nest. You'd think that it was like a duvet, so warm, but it too is leaking a little bit of heat out. This is a shot from underneath. You can see a little bit of adults, I think, moving there. But not quite as insulated as I thought it was going to be.
I would have thought all of that moss, woven together with spider's web, strong and flexible, very often used by birds like this, would have been a perfect insulator, but it's not. And Martin, having looked at all of that, we've come up with our own nest efficiency rating here. You see, higher, the very efficient nest, well, that's the pied flycatcher in a natural hole. The crow, not bad with its leaky bottom. Pied flycatcher here in a nest box, leaking lots of energy, and goldcrest absolutely at the bottom. So if you're thinking of selling your nest, you'll need to prepare one of these before you pass it on to another bird.
Now, I want to give you breaking news, Chris. Very, very exciting. This paper here, I was speaking to Dr. Charles Denning today. This paper was published on the 21st of May this year.
That's fresh, mate.
It's fresh. It's new science, this. And what it says, in essence, is that blue tits and great tits modify the insulation in their nests as you go north to south across the country. So blue tit and great tit nests in the south of the country have less insulation than ones right up in the north. So in Scotland, the nests would be very heavily insulated. That's breaking news, Chris. They modify the insulation.
It's breaking news, but it might have been predictable, and it's always satisfying to come up with a theory. Well, it's colder in the north than in the south, generally speaking. So you might expect that. But I'll tell you another thing that makes you think, you know, if that much heat is leaking out of an artificial nest box compared to the natural tree hole, from which very little heat was leaking out. When you're siting your nest box, you really want to put it somewhere where it's quite well sheltered, out of the way of the wind, to give them a better chance, because it must count, otherwise there wouldn't be more nest material in those northern nests.
Wise words, mate.